It's my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker. ENRICO CESARETTI is a professor of Italian at the University of Virginia. He was educated both in Italy and the United States, a laurea from Italy, an MA, and the doctorate from the United States. And he has established himself as really a go-to scholar for a number of thematics, as is clear from the title of his books and essays. He's the author and editor of numerous books, which include Castelli di Carta, Retorica della dimora tra scapigliatura e surrealismo. I will add here one of the few Italian critics to use the word surrealismo. Fictions of Appetite, Alimentary Discourses in Italian Modernist Literature. Landscape, Natures, Ecologies, Italy, and the Environmental Humanities, which is an edited volume that he co-edited with Serenella Iovino and Elena Past. And Elemental Narratives, Reading Environmental Entanglements in Modern Italy. This latest book explores the narrative eloquence and agency of some of the materials, such as concrete, steel, marble, petroleum, and the like, that have contributed to make and simultaneously unmake modern Italy. His articles, in turn, have appeared in the best of scholarly venues, and I'll name a few: Italian Studies, Italica, Modern Language Notes, Comparative Literature, Romance Notes, Ecozone with the Chiocciola, and Symposium. His most recent research has been focused in the field of the environmental humanities and eco-criticism. To this end, he is currently working on an article that approaches Italian science fiction through eco-criticism, and he's doing research on Naturismo Futurista. The title of his talk you can see here, and I present ENRICO CESARETTI.
If, as Lawrence Buell suggests in this quote, no genre potentially matches up with the planetary level of thinking environment better than science fiction does, science fiction is particularly well suited to engage with planetary narratives of the Anthropocene, or better, given the focus of this essay, of the plantationocene, to use Donna Haraway's term. It is by now also a given, after Frederick Jameson's insight in his Archaeologists of the Future, that the genre is inseparable from the more specific socio-historical context in which it emerges. It mirrors the place where it is produced. In the most successful cases, global questions and local concerns coexist and are in an inherently transnational and porous productive conversation with each other. Transnational and porous was a quote by Brioni and Comberiati, two scholars that have worked on Italian science fiction. To exemplify, one might thus say that a classic science fiction film such as Invasion of the Body Snatchers, 1956, is both about universal anxieties of losing one's humanity and individuality to become emotionless, vegetable-like pod people, and localized paranoias, namely McCarthy's America's fear of being invaded by an undifferentiated mass of communists, or at least communal thinking persons. Another given, which may be immediately gleaned from my far from casual example, is that the sci-fi genre and the horror genre as well have made ample use of the vegetal word to achieve their literary and cinematic purposes. Flowers, trees, seeds, agricultural crops, botanical life, and more in general, the vegetal dimension, perhaps just because of its simultaneous proximity to an alien-like ontological alterity from us, has frequently been a trope and a source of artistic inspiration for many classics in Anglo-American science fiction literature and cinema throughout the decades, from the birth of the genre in the late 19th century until today. And just to think, think about Wells' The Flowering of the Strange Orchid, John Collier's Green Thoughts, Ray Bradbury's The Green Morning, Ursula Le Guin, the word for word is forest, more recently Octavia Butler's Parable of the Sower, Sue Burke's Semiosis, popular films such as The Happening, 2008, and James Cameron, Avatar. All those are Anglo-American example of films and books that deal with vegetables. Despite its comparatively peripheral status, decentralized position within the rhetoric of the Anthropocene, and yet a prevalent human-centered disposition and focus, I argue that Italian sci-fi, too, offers some intriguing instances of literary botanical imagination, which, in line with the intertextual dynamics of cultural translation discussed by Brioni and Comberiati, are not always derivative imitations or adaptations of their Anglo-American counterparts. As such, at least some of this Italian green-tinged sci-fi is likely to represent and offer original insights into situated themes and topics uncommon to the national tradition, including those dealing with social, environmental, and ecological issues. A look at Giulia Iannuzzi's erudite overview of Italian sci-fi between the 50s and the 70s and beyond, she has two large volumes dedicated to the field, already reveals several works in which the vegetal dimension plays a substantial role in the plot. Leaving aside minor short stories undistinguished for their originality, in which the protagonist, in one of them, the protagonist tries to steal an extraterrestrial plant seeds because of their immune-enhancing qualities against a deadly virus. I found this particularly timely given the time we are living. My essay, my presentation, begins with some reflections on two sci-fi novels closely published in the 70s. The first one is Gilda Musa's Jungla Domestica, Domestic Jungle, which was published in 1975, with its depiction of a greenhouse full of sentient and expressive plants, apparently capable of vengeance and moral judgment, and Lino Aldani's Quando le Radici, When the Roots, 1977, set in a northern Italy where most of the people live in megalopolises and the rest of the country is under the control of industrial agribusiness. Set respectively on the hills around Parma and between Rome and the northern imaginary village of Pieve Lunga, these works might well share the label of fantascienza padana, Po Valley sci-fi, a distance from over-technological hard sci-fi, and an interest in exploring alternative kinds of relations and interactions, be they between different species, such as humans and plants, not to mention implicitly men and women in Musa's novel, or between distinct socioeconomic, ethnic, and geographical landscapes in Aldani's texts. Given their author's prolificity and relative fame, at least among sci-fi insiders, they already drew some critical attention, although not usually an eco-critical one. In the last part of my presentation, I then take the liberty to hyper-jump to the present time to briefly explore some very recent examples of Italian solarpunk speculative short fiction, which continue to display a vivid vegetal imagination. In particular, Giulia Bate's Il Libro di Flora, Flora's book, Serena Barbacetto's La Semina, The Sowing, and Francis Conforti's Pilastri di Luce, Pillars of Light, all collected in the book that you see, Assalto al Sole 2020, the first solar punk anthology of Italian authors curated by Franco Ricciardello. In comparisons with earlier sci-fi works, either Italian or not, these contemporary narratives share an even more explicit environmental agenda, which may occasionally take the form of plant-inspired gestures of adaptation to and radical resistance in a rapidly changing world. At the same time, within the limited scope of this presentation, they also well exemplify and reflect solarpunk's philosophy as they offer a more optimistic, utopian counterpart to the altogether darker socio-environmental vision that emerges in Musa's and Aldani's novels. All these texts turn out to be particularly suitable for an approach informed by a constellation of critical notions in eco-criticism, such as ecophobia, Simon Estock's term, agri-logistics, Timothy Morton's term, Vegetal Violence, Priscilla Wald, and lastly, the dark green, Heather Sullivan. And by studies addressing questions of interspecies relations, plant intelligence and communication, Michael Marder, that ultimately wishes to emphasize the fruitful, sensitizing, and awareness-raising role of Italian sci-fi in environmental discourses. Although Giulia Giannuzzi devoted half a page to Jungla Domestica, to Musa's Jungla Domestica in her chapter on the writer, she synthetically captures some essential aspects of the novel, namely how the plants in the greenhouse are closely related to the protagonist's identity. Costanza is a female botanist who inherited her passion from her scientist grandmother, Adriana, also a specialist in the field, and how the abuse and the violence she suffers because of her male housemates, Attilio, her ex-partner, and his painter friend Ennio, are gender-related. Incidentally, Jungla Domestica came out in Italy right in the middle of a decade marked by a number of non-science fictional yet equally extraordinary events that contributed to shift domestic power relations, gender hierarchies, and to recognize women's agency. Think about the law on divorce, 1970, the law on gender equality within marriage, 1975, the law on abortion, 1978, which, while in the background, certainly add another layer and interpretive dimension to the text. This said, the interconnections between plant life and death, human beings and gender, is a crucial leitmotif that immediately situates Musa's story in an eco-feminist light, which not only reproposes conventional associations between women and nature. At the risk of spoiling the ending, the conclusive self-sacrifice of the extraterrestrial vegetal creatures, which follows their avenging Costanza's tribulations, indicates how both the woman's survival and the reflourishing, as well as the deaths of her male antagonists, simultaneously depend and impinge on the plant's life. Ostensibly, this situation also points to the multiple, often irresolvable dilemmas of care that arise between the competing needs of different kinds of human beings and those of the environment at large. What are the potential consequences, Musa's novel seems to philosophically ask, of assigning a hierarchical priority to intelligent, responsive plants over ungrateful, problematic humans in questions of care and love? Who should be privileged? And who ultimately needs and or deserves such care and love most? Since between Costanza and her plants, there is a clear reciprocal support. You can see the quote, un accordo, un'intesa senza parole, che assomiglia a un dialogo più che a un monologo, una singolare e misteriosa complicità umano-vegetale. I just read the Italian and you read. The text invites us to accept an agentic botanical intelligence as integral to any ethics of care. While in a wider perspective, it also asks us to reflect on the extinction risk faced by those careless, violence-prone humans like Antilio and Ennio, who ignore such an ethics and disregard the possibility of such a human, non-human complicity. As Ennio puts in a conversation that takes place in the greenhouse with Dr. Ricci, a potential buyer of his artworks, he thinks of plants as inanimate entities. Mi sono indifferenti, le considero oggetti. Anche in questo quadro le ho rese simili a minerali. Deve stamparsi nel cervello che quelle là non hanno voce né occhi né mani né dita. Sono vegetali, come l'insalata e le cipolle. Vegetali. E basta. Attilio and Ennio are thus characterized by an essentially ecophobic, and again, as Simon Sesko's term, attitude towards nature, plants, and women that is objectifying, exploitative, and ultimately self-defeating. This fear may be traced in multiple instances through the text, but finds perhaps its clearest expression when Ennio, increasingly anxious and stressed, begins to lose some of his blindness to the vegetal world and explicitly tells a female friend, "Sono le piante, Lia, sono loro che mi spaventano. Le odio quelle piante, le distruggerei tutte se ne avessi il coraggio." Ecophobia, writes Simon Estock, exists on a spectrum, quote, exists on a spectrum and can embody fear, contempt, indifference, or lack of mindfulness, or some combinations of these, toward the natural environment. And it is all about frustrated agency, end quote. This definition could not be more fitting to describe Costanza's male housemates, both unsuccessful, failing painters, unable and unwilling to support themselves and their stunted careers without Costanza's hospitality and financial help. As soon as they are introduced, the two men display an utter disregard for both the host and the house, oikos, where they live, and engage in an increasingly insensitive, consumptive, extractive, and violent acts that culminate with their beating and presumed killing of Costanza in front of her beloved plants, silent and indifferent witnesses to this tragic event. The fact that these men display an irrational loss of control and that they fail even in performing their homicidal act, readers soon will find out that Costanza survived the attack and found refuge with a supportive male friend, signals their fundamental impotence and inability, and as Estock suggests in his reflections on the notion of tragedy, it implicitly unsettles them, quote, from a position of an imagined singular embodiment of agency, subjectivity, and ethical entitlements, end quote. Additionally, their indifference and thoughtlessness in trying to materially dispose of Costanza's body, hastily hiding it in a rubbish dump near an incinerator, is yet another sign of their ecophobia. While one might observe how the narrator takes advantage of this turn in the plot to comment on some of the rapid transformations that Italian landscapes, and the Po Valley in particular, were tangibly undergoing in real time, namely a period when industrial structures such as incinerators and cement plants began to dot the territory and can easily be pictured in the same site, I suggest that Estock's recent example, this slide from a cement factory in the Po Valley, which, just to give you, illustrate what the point I was making about seeing these things in the Po Valley. I suggested Estock's arguments on the relationship between waste and ecophobia resonate particularly well in the context of Musa's novel. Thinking, as Attilio and Ennio apparently do, that the human material they discard can be permanently kept away from returning to their world in one form or another, that it can be permanently made invisible and placed out of sight, betrays their essential ecophobic state. As Estock puts it once again, garbage, like nature, is the dangerous thing that touches the ecophobic consciousness with an agency that we want to keep at a distance from ourselves, thrown away, end quote, so that it does not disrupt and threaten our own agential power and sense of self-integrity. When, as in Jungla Domestica, such an agential waste overlaps with the beaten-up body of a survived, plant-loving woman that is partially buried under a strato di sostanze organiche, cartacce, scatolame, verdure di scarto, terriccio, end quote, and appears to merge with the landscape of the dump site itself, una collinetta di rifiuti gli si configura come un immenso corpo umano riverso al suolo, as if it were a sort of hybrid human junk vegetable and a dormant seed ready to germinate, the existential danger for the two culprits thus becomes even more real, and their subsequent plant-caused deaths almost a natural consequence of their fears and inconsiderate actions. As agency, subjectivity, and ethical entitlements are shifted from the human to the vegetal, the plants, far from being impassive and indifferent, show their reciprocal love for Costanza, retaliating first against Attilio and then Ennio, killing them with techniques which, although different, involve a self-sacrifice, arguably a suggestion that there are no real winners when different species, including men and women, rather than meeting halfway, the expression Karen Barad uses in her book, seem to prefer to exterminate each other. Emblematically, as a coda to these remarks, the new kind of relationship between human beings and plants Musa imagines may be located quite precisely in the text. If at the beginning of the story, the narrator hints at the passive, object-like materiality of plants, which are just a writing support and constitutive substance of the yellowed, earth-smelling paper of Costanza's grandmother's diary, dalla carta ingiallita alita un leggerissimo odore di terriccio e di miscugli vegetali, is the quote that I'm referring to. So the plants appear as the paper is a manifestation of plants. No? So at the conclusion of the book, plants, along with their kin-like female caregiver, are depicted as active subjects, main characters, and the real true protagonists of the extraordinary events in the new groundbreaking botanical book that Costanza, mirroring the author's own narrative path, eventually plans to co-write with them. So as we have seen, the increasingly industrialized landscape of the Po Valley appears in a peripheral yet also crucial turns in the plot of Musa's Giungla Domestica. Ugly, stinking dump sites surrounded by barbed wire, cement plants and their heavy machinery, series of gray incinerators with their horrible trash-moving bulldozers, all these lifted expressions from Musa's novel, stand out in her novel in contrast to the plants in Costanza's lush greenhouse as unequivocal signs of the author's attention and sensibility to the environmental challenges this geographical area, and by extension, the Italian peninsula as a whole, were concretely facing in the 60s and the 70s. An even more pervasive attention to post-economic boom, environmental and socio-political changes in Italy, in particular to the thoughtless urbanization processes and the related disappearance of historic rural areas, to the homogenization and mechanization brought by industrial agriculture at the expense of localized traditional vegetation and crops, and at the same time, to exploring further sci-fi's potential to reflect a critical relationship with the present day, may be found in Lino Aldani's Quando le radici. Displaying, like much of this author's sci-fi production, a pronounced interest for sociopolitical issues, this novel has already been productively addressed from an eco-critical angle by Simone Brioni and Daniele Comberiati, drawing on postcolonial theory and some of Deleuze and Guattari's work, the two scholars make insightful observations on how the text portrays, quote, the destruction of the rural environment as Italy strives to modernize and in the process transform the, quote, striated space of nomadism into a smooth, sedentary capitalist space, end quote, where pre-existing minorities group are exteriorized. As such, they focus especially on the novel's representation of otherness as embodied by the important characters of the Roma, here I use a word that is probably inappropriate, gypsies, it's not appropriate to use it, but I don't know, the Romani people is the right word, who appear in its second half. Heeding their discussion, in what follows, I provide just a few additional vegetal-inspired reflections to their catchy central idea that the roots in the book's title symbolically become roots, paths, forgive my Italian, my pronunciation, roots as radici and roots paths. For the protagonist, Arno Varin, named after a river, of Quando le Radici, when by eventually joining the group of nomads, rather than deciding to stay in his rural place of birth in the countryside, Pieve Lunga, he becomes a, quote, mobile, flexible, voyaging subject instead of a sedentary, alienated person, end quote, from Brioni and Comberiati. Indeed, this transformation of roots into roots, and more in general, the presence of several references in the novel to travel and road trips, either by car or by horse-driven chariot, like the one of the Romani clan, to various kinds of mobility, to heavy machinery, to infrastructure building, un'autostrada di scorrimento a sei corsie e un gran bel ponte sul Po, per esempio, just to make an example, and most revealing to the shortage of oil and to the subsequent difficulties of procuring petrol coupons to fill up the protagonist's car. Italiani della benzina sono una merce introvabile. La benzina non è facile. Sono rimasto quasi a secco. Invite to consider Aldani's fiction also as a peculiar kind of science fictional petrotext that may enrich the expanding field of Italian petrocultural studies. While keeping in mind that in Italy the early 70s coincided with the so-called period of austerity and its related heavily regulated gasoline consumption following the 1973 global oil crisis, I suggest that Heather Sullivan's notion of the dark green is especially useful to approach a novel which makes several references to the transformations of the country's botanical and agricultural landscape, and whose pages are simultaneously pervaded by the smell and taste of petrol or one of its toxic derivatives. Due volte all'anno vengono gli elicotteri, vengono a spargere quella specie di nebbia, gli anticrittogamici. Una nuvola di carburante combusto invase l'abitacolo. Era un po' difficile stabilire se quel liquido sporco e marrone sul fondo dell'insalatiera fosse davvero olio vergine d'oliva. Una nuvola pazza di combustibile bruciato contamina il sole e l'azzurro. Bistecche al metano, verdure conservate col difenile, insomma, c'è alcune espressioni. To clarify, with the expression dark green, Sullivan captures the long-term natural cultural interactions and dependencies that exist between human beings, plants, and petroleum, and underlines the vegetal organic origin of the latter, a hydrocarbon substance, quote, derived from long and varied forms of botanical output that grows, dies, rots underground, and then reemerges in new and fiery forms, end quote. That is also a quintessential expression of agentic plant power. Despite evident differences, the situation depicted in Quando le Radici shares also some similarities with the three American sci-fi dark green narratives revolving around failed road trips that Sullivan individuates and analyzes in her work. And these are Frank Herbert's Dune, 1965, Cormac McCarthy's The Road, and Paolo Bacigalupi's The Wind Up Girl. In these novels, as she puts it, the human figures, quote, seek meaningfully mobility, but fail in various ways, while plants, ever active, are still on the move or are totally gone. And the respective authors intertwine direct plant energy and mobility with various forms of the devastated or devastating plant product petroleum, end quote. Even though a road trip is certainly not as preeminent in Aldani's novel as, say, McCarthy's one, The Road, and as mentioned earlier, Arno, the protagonist, Arno's failures of planting his roots in Pieve Lunga also represents an achievement of sorts. There are a few doubts about the importance of his petroleum-fed motorway travels from Rome, where he lives, to the Po Valley, and in turn about the presence of and juxtaposition between various kinds of plant power. The latter manifests itself, for instance, as a source of automotive energy and mobility. Arno's car S138, Milena's called 171 special, fictional cars that never existed. Or again, plant power manifests itself as fuel for the trucks and as fertilizer for the monstrous agricultural machines affecting the landscape and the people of Pievelunga. Also, plant power manifests itself as an essential producer of oxygen and clean, breathable air. And last but not least, as the cause of what the narrator, portraying a momentarily relaxed Arno fishing along a lush section of the Po River, defines felicità vegetale, vegetal happiness, namely a pleasant plant-induced sensation that is also associated to Rana, unsurprisingly an expert Roma herbalist with whom he ultimately falls in love. To put it differently, in one way or another, the vegetal word in Quando le radici is far more present and relevant than the reference to the metaphorical roots in the title would make one think. While the vegetal dimension may not be in so much focus as it is in more blatantly explicit plant-centered stories, here too is, quote, the actual driver of the action. And quoting Sullivan again, one might say that if the vegetal fails, we fail. Among several options, two moments in the text convey this idea particularly well, as they hint both at the essential role of dark and green energy for human subsistence, and in turn at the conflict that exploding petrocultures have with their vegetal bases. In the first, we find Arno temporarily back in Rome, trying to convince an ex-flame of his, Milena, to join him in Pievelunga. Parcheggia la macchina nel piazzale intasato, sale sul nastro pedonale e un acuto malessere lo afferra la bocca dello stomaco. L'aria, gli manca l'aria, è asfittico. Allora infila una moneta nella fessura della macchinetta che distribuisce ossigeno. Aspira, appoggiato al bocchettone, poi l'aggeggio fa clic e cessa di erogare. Ma lui si fruga nelle tasche e ripete l'operazione. Prova pino silvestre, prova eucalipto, prova spuma di mare e fiori di campo. Li prova tutti finché non ha più spiccio. In a dystopian context where oxygen producing trees and forests have been almost completely erased to make room for plantation style cultivations and the implementation of agri-logistical strategies, and mega cities are choked by exhaust gases and smog, one must pay even to breathe some clean air artificially flavored with increasingly rare botanical essences. If Arno's trip has been enabled by vegetal-based fossil fuels, his own life and well-being similarly depend on what is left of an indispensable photosynthesis byproduct, now too ironically repackaged and commercialized for profit. In the asphyxiated, hellish urban world Aldani depicts, green-infused air, like dark petroleum, is another instance of plant agency and power, and ironically becomes another commodity to be purchased at the pump in order to fill up needy human bodies rather than empty tanks. The second moment, which extends throughout the novel's last chapter, signals Arno's simultaneous rejection of one kind of exhausted dark plant energy and his embrace of an alternative, green one, conducive to a new life. After selling his gas-guzzling car in order to regain a feeling of humanity, he says, "Voglio essere un uomo di carne e di sangue come voi," end quote. He also manages to sink in the Po River, the loud, unmanned, monstrous machinery with rotating blades that is destroying the woods and the fields near Pievelunga to build a new motorway, sollevando nuvole di vegetazione triturata, truccioli di ramaglia e pallottole di ortica. Paradoxically, however, by partially destroying his forest, this petrol-fueled monster is also symbolically cutting Arno's own roots, thus setting him free to eventually choose another form of more meaningful, nomad-like mobility. The fact that the latter is horse-centered and grass-fed rather than propelled by oil, and is associated with a Romani woman, Rama, who understands the value and properties of wild herbs, is yet another manifestation of the power of the vegetal in Quando le radici, and ultimately suggests that regardless of the energy, dark or green, that fuels our lives, the agency of plants is inexorably entangled with our progress, growth, and the literal and metaphorical possibility of moving forward towards the future. An even more explicit verdant imaginary, in combination with a hopeful utopian vision of a sustainable, better world powered by green energies, where human beings have learned lessons and practices of resilience and resistance from nature and plants, characterizes what one might call the weedy aesthetic informing the solar punk speculative movement. Initially emerged in the field of the visual arts from a global web-based social network microblogging platform, Tumblr, as an open source anti-capitalist anarchic reaction from below to the dystopian post-apocalyptic scenarios favored by the cyberpunk genre. If you know what cyberpunk, think of Blade Runner, where it's always rainy and dark. Solarpunk, as the name suggests, optimistically envisions a non-anthropocentric, socio-environmentally and ethically sound rethinking of society. The latter is supposedly carried out by diverse and diversely constituted in terms of nationality, gender, race, sexual preferences, enlightened communities and groups who, like weeds, fill in the gaps and coalesce where government fails to show up. Unsurprisingly, a botanical metaphor by A.D. Hudson, author of one of the most influential solarpunk web publications, helps to clarify this point. Quote, imagine a tree growing amidst rubble, rooting around rocks into open spaces, occasionally pushing cracks wider. The tree can't remove the concrete, but the concrete is too poorly maintained to stop it. In the same way, I think solarpunk should work to reinvent civilization from within. You've heard of the hacker slogan, quote, move fast and break things, end quote. Solarpunk should move quietly and plant things, end quote. Arguably inspired also by Michael Marder's ideas about the ontological possibilities plants may offer for contemporary political practices, it is no secret that solarpunk has still to fully flourish in its manifestation as a specific literary subgenre within the fields of ecofiction and or ecological sci-fi, both in English and even more in Italian. This said, as the selection of botanically inspired short stories I briefly address in this presentation suggests, some narrative things have been planted also in the sprouting Italian solarpunk sci-fi context. Both in Serena Barbacetto's La Semina and Francis Conforti's Pilastri di Luce, that which is actually planted, respectively, in Italy and in Africa, are seeds that eventually turn into eco-homes for human habitation. And along with them, the implicit ideas that scientific and technological advancements, here in particular in the fields of biogenetic engineering, design, artificial intelligence, and architecture, rather than being disruptive and contributing to social inequalities, could be conducive to global, more just forms of sustainability. In the overall desirable eco-modernist scenario that these two narratives depict, these vegetable homes become sentient living habitats that interact and grow together with their occupants and their descendants in a context of reciprocal care and empathic connection. However, while a semina consists in little more than a simple sketch of this plant-like biohome narrated by a young man excited to move into a newly constructed one, Pilastri di Luce adds some additional layers of complexity to its plot. First, in an imaginary nod to Gilda Musa's novel, we encounter another woman botanist, Sylvie Dubois, who is passionate to share her scientific knowledge in the war-torn and trash-filled country of Mali, where she works as a teacher and an activist opposed to the exploitation and abuse of local resources. In this colonial context, a for-profit corporation, Jenks, has a plan to bio-build experimental tree homes, which Sylvie, in her well-meaning yet also rigid Western ecological attitude, despises as unsafe GMO chimeras. For this reason, she opposes them and does not want to see them test planted in the local trash town of Konna. Ultimately, however, Sylvie's position changes after a conversation and a dice game named Pillar, hence the title of the story, played with a tattooed-covered indigenous man who lives in one of these tree homes. After better understanding his animist attitude and sense of time, Sylvie sees that it's also possible to have non-exploitative and more ethical forms of vegetal biobuilding, and that her efforts towards improving the local situations are misdirected. At the end of this game, enlightened by this indigenous man and by a rare natural phenomenon known as the Pillar of Light, Sylvie departs from her earlier skeptical disposition and finally acknowledges that even in an apparent dystopian third world environment dominated by corporate greed and Western capitalism, there are sparkles of sustainable plant-derived hope. Mi viene in mente la strofa di una canzone di secoli fa, she says. Dai diamanti non nasce niente, dal letame nascono i fiori. È un verso di Fabrizio De André. Da una canzone di Fabrizio De André, Via del Campo. Subverting traditional power balances and recognizing the value of indigenous forms of knowledge, this short story ultimately suggests that real innovation and a path for a sustainable future may indeed emerge in a primitive colonial setting if, however, human beings and their vegetal oikos care and are responsive and responsible to each other's needs. As Eve, the indigenous man, tells Sylvie, quando questa storia è iniziata, la casa era uno schifo e io ero uno schifo. Su di me questa casa ha fatto un ottimo lavoro. Guardami, figo, no? End quote. Significantly, another female botanist, Flora Conti, is the protagonist also in Giulia Abate's Il Libro di Flora, The Book of Flora, arguably the most ambitious and thought-provoking among these three stories that I'm considering here. Opened by a quote from Laura Conti's environmental classic, Da Questo Pianeta, From This Planet, 1983, this utopian tale set in a dystopian environment imagines a future when young women are trained as scientists and indoctrinated as offspring generators to serve a state-sponsored terraforming colonization of Mars. In particular, female phytoagronomists are asked to leave their families behind and depart from one among several Italian spaceports, here Taranto Grottaglie, to colonize Mars. Their job is to convince similarly deported plant seeds to grow and generate crops for human consumption on these inhospitable habitats of Mars greenhouses. Despite the seeds' evolutionary physiological resistance to a literal and metaphorical uprooting, avevano preferito sviluppare l'arte dell'esistenza in modo radicato e cognitivamente profondissimo. Erano le loro storie che dovevamo ascoltare. End quote. Although a spreading anarchist feminist guerrilla publication entitled Il Libro di Eva, The Book of Eva, represents a thorn in the side of the state and an important source of inspiration for the subversive anti-colonization prop resistance movement, as a mere and thus limited human-produced narrative, it remains insufficient to really implement an effective emancipative project of liberation and cosmopolitical planetary palingenesis. The latter objective, and with it, a new non-colonial form of ecology, Il Libro di Flora suggests, can only be achieved by overcoming the limitations of anthropocentric narratives, by assimilating, quote, come un virgulto fa col concime, end quote, as a shoot does with manure, both discursive and material stories, and by listening to and interpreting the messages of plants, la vera lingua della vita che era verde, the true language of life, which was green, says the protagonist. As the first-person narrator Flora puts it, the female scientist directed to Mars, and we too, should eventually learn to read a different book called Il Libro di Gaia, of which her book is ostensibly a chapter, that teaches, quote, the rudimenti della neurolinguistica vegetale, the rudiments of plant neurolinguistics, so that by collaborating with plants rather than by exploiting them, the whole ecosystems made of humans, fauna, and flora can survive and thrive. Curandoci le une delle altre, possiamo sviluppare nuove radici e le piante guarirci. By caring for each other, we can develop new roots and the plants heal us. Expectedly, before this non-hierarchical condition of coexistence, care, and collaboration between the human and the vegetal dimension may be even imagined, and before Flora may feel the pulsating and sympathizing emanations of viriditas, as she puts it, the patriarchal, oppressive, governmental system of thought and power must be eliminated. And as the killing of a stolid administrator and the destruction of the Taranto Grottaglie spaceport with the adjacent Ilva steel plant indicate, violence remains an option in this process of liberation. At this point, however, I do not wish to spoil more of the plot. Rather, as a way to conclude and wrap up this plant-centered excursion into Italian science fiction, I would just observe that such violent fictional acts, like those performed by the killing plants in Musa's novel, or by Arno Varen at the end of Quando le radici, when he throws the machinery in the Po River, are themselves utterly radical gestures that make visible, respond, and counteract to what Priscilla Wald calls the structural, slow, vegetal violence of capitalism, the violence suffered by the earth as registered in its vegetation, end quote, and convert it into an embryonic vegetal counterviolence. Or, to put it differently, these literary science fictional acts of resistance and counter-violence might be viewed as seeds, eventually generating a different sociopolitical and environmental order, restituting both, quote, to the vegetal member of ecosystems as much as to human communities, their right to exist, to grow, and to flourish. And these are the words by Michael Marder in his book. Thank you.
So I was just wondering, I'm science fiction is not something that I've have a lot of experience with, but I recently read a book by the Japanese author Ishiguro, and I wondered if you were familiar with Clara and the Sun.
I am familiar with the title. I've not read the book.
Well, something you said that just made me remember that I just finished this book not that long ago. This idea of destroying machinery, which I find really interesting. And the main character of the book is an AI. So it's sort of like an artificial friend for a young teenage girl. And she believes that the sun has you know, it's about the sun giving life to the earth. And when she sees this machine in the city that is blocking, is creating pollution that's blocking out the sun, she decides she has to destroy it. Mm-hmm. So it's very interesting to think of a machine, kind of a, you know, artificial intelligence that is then killing these older generation machines, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. This kind of machinery killing machinery. Mm-hmm. And in a weird way, it made me think about what you said regarding petroleum, you know, the basis of it being vegetal, and the idea that these two sides, we have to do something other than say it's, you know, man against machine or nature against machine. There has to be. So anyway, it's not really a question. It's just kind of an observation.
Yes, very, very interesting. It's also another form of, it's a kind of form of AI. We think of AI or the as the digital world. No, we usually think as the AI as separated from the fossil fuel industry. But as a matter of fact, that's, as we all know, it's not true. No, AI has a cost. There's a material presence. There is a beautiful book by Yussi Parikka, who writes about the techno-fossil and talks about the impact, the environmental impact of the cloud, of all this. And they, of course, companies are very smart in thinking about names, you know, air, cloud, everything is ethereal. But as a matter of fact, there are, as we all know, dumps in Bangladesh where there are people getting mineral metals, heavy metals. There is a strong component of material heaviness behind all these ethereal suggestions. So, yeah, but so it's interesting that this new artificial intelligence kills the old one. You know, it's like I don't know how, I haven't read the book. I said so. I don't know how he presents it, but it could be. I mean, I'd be interested in seeing if it's seen as positive or such as a negative. Kind of reproduces the idea, you know, that by going digital, by buying electric, we solve the problems. Not totally there.
Hi, thank you for that talk. So in two of the stories you mentioned that there's some moves to either like nomadic practices or indigeneity, and I was wondering if you see those moves as a type of like greenwashing of like primitivism or orientalism on the behalf of like the Italian authors.
Well, I didn't read that in that way. I thought the idea of nomadism is just explored by Simone Brion, by Comberiati and Brion in their reading of the novel by Varin. And because this novel has a character that is a Romani, that's very interesting. So they read, they interpret this as very productively as, you know, moving again from this static to this nomadic life with all the positive aspects that are present within this gesture. Sorry, I forgot the question. The last part, I was.
If you saw it as a greenwash.
Yeah, the greenwash. Yeah, I don't think there was at the time of Aldani. There was not much green. At the time the novel was written, there was not yet coined. The word was not there. So I think it is something that we might want to. I don't see that very much from, because at that time it was rather a serious concern with what was going on in Italy, and what is present might be from today's perspective that we think everything is greenwashed, you know. So we are kind of biased, and every time we approach texts that present. This kind of scenario, but
I just had a quick question about a couple of the short stories of the Solarpunk collection. It made me think a lot of Octavia Butler's Xenogenesis trilogy.
Yes,
especially with regards to the houses. And I was wondering if there was a more symbiotic relationship besides the fact that the plant houses are there for the people to live in. Do they eat the refuse of the environment as well? Do they do other things?
It's not there. It's not in the story. They don't eat. These homes are built in this, I don't know, again, I'm concerned about the term. It's a trash town. It's a garbage town. This is in a colonial setting in Africa. And so there is this corporation that somehow wants to, as the practice has been, you know, that you test new things, not in your homeland, you test them some other place. In this colonial code. But the positive aspect of this story, the solar punk position, you know, it can be good. I came late to solar punk. I'm not an expert on this. I learned for this paper, the research that I've done, but I am a little skeptical. I think it's a little naive, you know, and I am more pessimistic. I am a very tendentially, I see the glass half empty most of the time. So I am not, it's difficult for me to go along very well with these images. I enjoy them, and I like that somebody's thinking still. And I want to think positive as well, but I'm afraid that that as every day we wake up and it's difficult to. So, to answer your question, no, the homes are not edible homes. There is nothing really to that aspect. So they are just sprouting up in this very dirty and colonial environment. And still something positive can come out of there. So that's their message. That's the Solarpunk idea. No? And the pictures I sent you was all the kind of architecture. There's a whole other field, you know, of this oikos, the new environments with, like, think about the Giardino Verticale, you know, the vertical garden in Milan. So that is probably that's the greenwashing part, probably, you know, that there is this kind of marketing for a very elite, very few people. You build one building, and okay, I'm done. And the rest of the city, in the meantime, is choking with smog. So that doesn't really help kind of urban sustainability of the whole metropolis, unless everybody with different kind of level of wealth can access some kind of habitation that has that kind of effect.
Other questions?
My question is, when they speak about plants and vegetable or vegetation, do they say plant, roots, shoot in general, or do they give scientific names? Do they use any previous botanic knowledge? Any specificity, the willow tree, the oak tree, something more specific, or just
wait, which I don't know, maybe what was I talking about?
I think you were about
the Solarpunk thing?
Yeah,
or the Solarpunk? No, they don't give. So they talk about they use a scientific name for the scientists, where they need to be neuro. They use scientific name for the discipline that the scientists need, neuroethnobotanists or whatever they call it. But the plants are not individuated by their scientific name, so it's just a general. It's a seed. It's a general pod seed that grows.
Okay.